welcome to debate. I know, like, it's not ideal that you're the only person, but at least you can get some additional practice and all of your questions answered here. All of our, like, sessions will be recorded, and they will also be uploaded to the Baudl YouTube. So if you ever, like, need to review or, like, miss any concepts, feel free to, like, reference that. So this is Debate Novice Edition. I know you're in middle school, but you are participating in policy. So you will be a novice right now. Honestly, I think that you will be ready to probably transition to like our open division by like the end of the year. So you're on top of it. You're good. So what's on today's agenda? So we're going to take attendance. It's not going to be that long because, you know, only one person's in attendance, but that's, you know, more than enough. So I'm just going to write your name down. Ella is here. Okay, cool. And what school are you from again, Ella? Is it Ames?
Parkside,
okay. Cool. So attendance, then we're gonna do some speaking drills, if you remember those from camp, just to get your voice warmed up, get that like speaking points up. And then we're gonna do a little activity. It might be a little hard with two people, but of course we can adapt, we can adjust. We can do some more flowing drills, and then we're going to go over the negative packet, which is really, really great because you went to the workshop on Saturday, so you already have a bit of experience with the affirmative, so now you'll get a chance to look at the neg. And then, of course, we'll close it out today with any closing statements, questions, comments, concerns, all that good stuff. So now that we already did attendance, we're going to do speaking drills. They're going to be 2 minutes each. So the first one we are going to be doing is called speed, and that is where you read as fast as you possibly can, but I'll give you a minute just to find something to read. So you can either pull up the evidence packet like on your laptop in a separate window, read off the evidence packet, or you can just grab a book that if you have in your room or like in your house somewhere to read off of. You can also use any middle school evidence you have from last year, like any physical copies. You can choose to read out of that as well. Just literally anything that you can read off of. So I'll give you a minute to grab that. I'm also going to stop sharing my screen so I can pull up a timer. So we're going to do this activity. It can just be me and you since we're a little low on numbers today, but that's totally fine. So this is just trying to get us like, you know, warmed up and used to arguing against things. That's like the role of the neg. Your job is to go against whatever the app says. So within this activity, devil's advocate, we do not need to form two groups because it's just you and me. And then one person is going to make a statement like, I believe homework is a complete waste of time. And then whatever a statement the first person makes, the other person is just going to completely disagree with it. Be like, I couldn't disagree with you more. Homework helps us practice things we learned in class so we don't forget. And then we just keep going and like keep disagreeing. And then whatever you want, you can like introduce a new topic, you can change it up, just like give a new statement that you agree with, and then we'll just go back and forth like that. If you, for whatever reason, cannot think of a response or a valid reason as to why you disagree, then you would metaphorically be out of the game. Any questions? Okay, cool. Yeah, and I was like, when I mean valid reason, I mean like, you can't just say like, I disagree with you because homework sucks or something like that. Like, you know, it has to be like a reason, like a valid reason, but of course it's subjective. So we can figure it out as we go. Would you like to propose a statement or would you like me to give a statement?
I can give a statement.
Okay.
I believe that school uniforms should be abolished because do I have to say because in the first one?
Do whatever you gotta do. Keep going.
Okay.
You got it.
I believe that school uniforms should be abolished because they limit freedom of speech. Sorry, expression.
Okay, perfect. So they limit freedom of speech and expression. I couldn't disagree with you more because uniforms allow students to even the playing field and that it eliminates any like economic disparities because they can all wear the same uniforms. So no one can wear like fancy designer brands and flaunt their wealth against other students.
I couldn't disagree with you more because in the real life that could just happen anytime. So basically we're not preparing the kids for anything. We're just having them be introduced to that when they're older.
I couldn't disagree with you more, because school should be a safe space for kids to learn, and they shouldn't have to worry about money while they're trying to get their education.
I couldn't disagree with you more, because even if they shouldn't, if kids shouldn't be able to flaunt, as you put it, flaunt their wealth, it's still, school dress codes in terms of color can limit supporting people who are going through rough times. For example, there was a high school in the US that a bunch of kids started wearing pink to support Breast Cancer Month, and a lot of them got suspended.
I couldn't disagree with you more, because school uniforms can prevent other color disparities against other students. So while some colors may be productive, other colors may not be as productive. So as a way to even the playing field, we should just maintain our uniforms. And if they want to support breast cancer outside of school, they have the freedom to do so then.
I couldn't disagree with you more, because they should be able to say what they believe in inside of, well, show what they believe in inside of school by what they wear, because they can't go, because even if they were to say it, they can't go around just saying, I believe in blah, 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 because that would take up too much time. If they just wear it, that shows a lot of support.
I couldn't disagree with you more. Students within school, they have more than enough time to express themselves outside of it. However, in order to ensure that everyone is on an even playing field, we have to maintain our uniforms.
I couldn't disagree with you more, because people can still wear fancy brands. For example, in my school, we can still wear like headbands or scrunchies, or even our sweaters, as long as they don't have a logo or something on them. They can still be whatever.
I couldn't disagree with you more. The prevention of logos ensures that wealth is not being flaunted, so that is okay in the situation.
I couldn't disagree with you more, because wealth can still be flaunt if there's only one brand who makes that type of clothing that way. So then it's obvious that that's that brand. And if it's fancy, it's probably not going to be similar to a lot of other brands.
I couldn't disagree with you more. You see how it goes, right? Like, we have to keep going. Do you want to continue with uniforms, or do we want to do another topic before we move on?
We can continue with the uniforms.
You want to continue with uniforms? Okay. All right, then. Okay, we can totally continue with uniforms. Okay, so you said that scrunchies, like some designer brands, specialize in like not having logos.
I think what I said was something about how as long at my school, you can wear a lot of like sweaters and stuff, as long as they don't have a logo. And then you said that nobody would be able to tell their brands or whatever. And I said that if it's a fancy or expensive brand, it probably doesn't look like a lot of other clothing.
I couldn't disagree with you more. Within the school uniform guidelines, it has to be plain, so no patterns can be like eluded on the clothing. And without the addition of patterns, you cannot tell the difference between like a $10,000 scrunchie and like a $5 scrunchie.
I couldn't disagree with you more, because sometimes the way they are made can show. It doesn't have to have a specific pattern.
I couldn't disagree with you more. I don't think any students are really going to examine the stitch work on a scrunchie. Instead, they're going to hopefully pay attention to their schoolwork, so it shouldn't cause as much of a distraction to the students.
I could not disagree with you more, because sometimes when people, can you hear background noise?
You're totally good.
Okay. Sometimes people are able, I mean, some people, a lot of people don't focus on school even though they're supposed to be doing work, they may be looking at other people, like their clothes or whatever, just looking around the room and notice that. And a lot of people are bullied because they don't wear a certain brand.
I couldn't disagree with you more. That's why we have school uniforms, to eliminate the addition of brands within schools.
I couldn't disagree with you more, because someone can still be wearing a brand, as we've already discussed.
I couldn't disagree with you more. As long as the brand is not visible to the students, then there shouldn't be any issue when determining whether or not it is a distraction or not in class.
I couldn't disagree with you more, because I feel like we're just tracing circles.
Yeah. Cool. So that is the gist of the activity. Essentially, what, like, you know how like you just have to keep disagreeing. Like at one point when you were talking about like self-expression within classrooms, like I totally agreed students should be able to express themselves within school. However, I had to, you know, still maintain that like I'm the opposing side. So I had to, you know, keep going against it. But like, that's just kind of like the appropriate, you have to be the devil's advocate in a way, you know? So when you're the neg, even though you may agree with what the affirmative is saying, you still have to argue against it. And there's other ways to do it. Like there should never be an instance in which you should like compromise a super hard standing moral that like you live by in debate, like, or you have to like immediately take like the super like racist or prejudice route in a round. That should never be an option when you're playing like the debater's devil's advocate. There are so many routes and avenues that you can take that like being like either racist or like prejudiced or like harassing the other side is never a resort, you know? So we'll talk about like the different avenues you should take. Just know that that should never be an option that you should like, or like you should never go against your morals, you know? Like there's so many ways you can debate. We'll go into it as we talk about it. So, but before we go into the negative side, we're going to do a little bit of more flowing practice. I know you've got a little bit of introduction through flowing through camp and through like the workshop this weekend, so you kind of already know what it is, but we can do another activity. So if you have any paper, feel free to go grab it right now. We're going to do a few flowing drills. So you can get that out. Let me stop sharing my screen, and you already know what they look like. So we're going to do some flowing practice, as you can see. So I'll let you grab that. Let me pull up a card game. All right, you ready? Cool. So I have some cards on my phone because I don't have a physical deck in my dorm right now, but I have I'm going to be reading off like 10 cards at a time or so, and you're just going to put them into your flow sheet and just like write them down as I go. I'll start kind of slow, and then as we go through the rounds, I'll increase my speed and we'll see, like, just check in and see how you're doing with like writing things down. Do you have any questions? Cool. And of course, you know that you can abbreviate the cards. Like you don't have to write out the word spade or club or hearts. Like you can just put the symbol and like the number, like whatever's easiest for you. As long as you can read your flow, that's how it can help you. All right. So I'm gonna list some cards. This is gonna be round one, so I'm gonna go slow. Okay, so my first card is Queen of Hearts, Four of Diamonds, Six of Diamonds, Four of Spades, Six of Hearts, Three of Diamonds, Ace of Hearts, Eight of Hearts, Queen of Clubs, and Ace of Clubs. All right, how was that?
I just missed one of them. I usually am not very good when it comes to cards.
Oh, okay. Like the... it's really like, is it the symbol, like the suit, like a spade, club, those things?
Yeah, I think so. I can't just like match a spade to my drawing. I have to visualize what it is.
True. All right. I feel that, but everything else was pretty good. How about the speed? Was it too fast, too slow?
No, not really. Not really too fast, I mean.
Okay. Do you want to do another round with cards? We can also, I haven't done it with like other things, but we can try, like we can do animals. We can do fruits. Like I can just list off random things and I can see if you can like follow them. Do you want to try different things or do you want to save the cards?
You can try different things.
Cool. All right. Let's try animals. We'll see how that works. Let me pull it up. Random animal generators. Oh, okay. We're going to. Okay. You ready? Cool. So for the round of animals, we have anteater, gorilla, hedgehog, prairie dog, kangaroo, jackal, and leopard. All right, how was that?
I got all of them. But
so introduction to the negative side. So what is the role of the negative and what do you do if you agree with the app? So the role of the negative is to contradict the affirmative. So as negative in policy debate, you know how the affirmative presents a policy action saying we should do this, right? The role of the neg isn't necessarily to give a better solution. It's just to say that their plan is bad, right? So I guess if you boil down the role of the neg has to prove that the status quo, which essentially is what is going on currently without the plan being introduced, is better than a world with the plan introduced. That is the whole role of the neg. So the neg doesn't have to solve the problem. It just has to prove that the plan that the affirmative is going to introduce is going to make everything fundamentally worse than it already is. Now, that doesn't mean that the neg can't introduce solutions such as counterplans, right? Like you'll get into those as you move up divisions, and counterplans are just like another policy action that's proposed into the round. So if the AF is saying we should force everybody to go vegan right off the bat, a counterplan that the neg could suggest would be like, no, instead of making everybody go vegan, we should make them go vegetarian because it's easier and more accessible, right? Like the neg can do that, but that's not necessarily the neg's role. The neg's role is just to completely say that by making everybody go vegan, it's going to make the world completely worse than it already is now. Again, everything else after that is just perks. Like the counterplan making everybody go vegetarian, that's a perk. Like adding on like disadvantages to the plan, we'll go into that as we go. But like, do you kind of understand what I'm saying? So the role of the neg is just to show that the plan is going to make the situation worse.
Yep.
Perfect. And then what do you do if you agree with the affirmative side? That's kind of going on to what we were talking about with the devil's advocate. You may agree with what the app says. Like you might be like, hey, making everybody go vegetarian is a good idea. Like, you know, like we need to stop consuming animal products. It's not good for the environment, X, Y, Z. However, as the neg, you cannot just say that's a good idea. What else you can do, you can then propose a counterplan, so give a better idea, or you can just prove that this plan is, like, you just have to find some way to justify that this plan will not work in the situation. So you still have to go against it, even if you think it's a good idea, but you'll find other avenues that you can grasp to kind of still get the point that you want across in the round. So what makes up the negative arguments? So within a neg, you have disadvantages, topicality, and case. Now, that's not all there is in a negative argument. However, these are the most common ones that you're going to get within novice. So, like, this isn't the end-all be-all of everything that covers the negative arguments. However, these are just the ones we're going to cover in novice for this semester. So disadvantages, topicality, and case. And we'll go into each one as we go through the cards. So disadvantages. So if you remember back to when we looked at the affirmative at the workshop how it has something called advantages. So advantages are just good things that happen from the plan. Disadvantages are all of the bad things that are going to happen for the plan. So kind of like consequences. So they, again, they have the same components as an advantage. However, they differ because one, disadvantages are the result of the plan, not an inaction of the plan. So it shows like, this is what happened if we directly pass the plan. That's a disadvantage. So this bad thing or this consequence is going to happen if we pass it. And it just, and again, it just really drills in that point that the world would be worse off with this plan than it would be without it. And then uniqueness shows that the status quo, that the plan would make the status quo worse. So uniqueness and link and internal link are all basically kind of really the same. So like the link is the connector between the disadvantage and the plan. So if we say that if we have the plan, let's say everybody should go vegan, and we're saying the disadvantage to that plan is that it makes, like, it'll reduce the amount of gas prices. You're like, what does that have to do with going vegan, right? What is the link between the reduction in gas prices and the forcing of everybody to go vegan? That is why links and internal links are so important, because in a round, you have to connect the two together in order for it to make sense. So if I were then to provide a link, I would say the reason why everybody going vegan would then reduce or increase gas prices is because all of those people that are like traveling back and forth with cattle, with all these dairy products and stuff like that is now gone, therefore reducing the amount of gas because people aren't buying it as much anymore. That is my link, right? You see how it like it connects the two together. So before they're just very two abstract ideas, like everybody going vegan, reduction of gas prices, right? How do we connect those? That is why the link is so important, because it shows you how it just basically connects them together. It shows the connections for the judge and shows that this plan is going to directly affect the consequence, the disadvantage. Those are links. Now the uniqueness is like similar to the link, but also showing that there's no other reason as to why gas prices would reduce. So you could say that like uniqueness kind of justifies the disadvantage and shows why it's so important that we don't pass this policy action. So if you think of like, you're like, you can say that actually gas prices aren't reducing because everybody's going vegan. They're reducing because there's a big push for like climate awareness and people are not trying to burn as much fossil fuel, right? So you can say that reduction of gas prices isn't unique to the plan because everybody's pushing for climate awareness, so people aren't driving less, therefore gas prices are down. So it's like it has nothing to do with the plan. Like there's external factors, so it's not unique to the vegan plan text. Does that make sense? So it's just showing that like it's not unique to this thing and that there's other factors. So if we were to vote for the plan, like reduction of gas prices are going to happen regardless because of climate change. So it doesn't affect it at all. That's kind of like uniqueness. But the uniqueness, if you're supporting NEG, could say like, there are no external factors, right? The reduction of gas prices is uniquely in consequence to passing the plan. So that is why passing the plan is a bad idea, because we don't want to reduce gas prices, even though we probably would, but like, you know, this is all an example. It's all made up. Like, you know, I think gas prices should be lowered, but whatever. And then the last part is the impact. So who is being affected by this? Who is being harmed by this? By this plan action, right? So if we are forcing everybody to go vegan, what is the disadvantage to that? Who is going to be impacted? You could say like lower income communities would be affected because it costs more for those products. So they wouldn't have as much accessibility to food. You can also say that lower income communities would then be forced to buy vegetarian, like vegetables that have a lot of pesticides or GMOs because they need to make them more affordable. And those would be the only ones they can afford to buy. These are just examples. I haven't really thought about this in detail, I'm making this up in my head, but as you can see, like who is affected by this plan action? So you're saying, no, we shouldn't force everybody to go vegan, because it would then affect lower income communities who can't afford like the organic stuff. So they're forced to eat more heavily pesticides, produce, which then can lead to a bunch of different health effects. So that's the impact. So these are all instances of disadvantages. Do you have any questions so far?
No, I think I got it.
Okay, perfect. So when we talk about disadvantages in like debate or in policy debate, they're just like, what? So yeah, it's in the definition of like a disadvantage. Like it's something bad that's gonna happen if we were to pass the plan. Topicality. So I don't think we're gonna get a lot of topicality in novice because there's not any critiques in the novice packet, but I'll briefly go over it in case, because you will see this as you move up divisions. Like when you move to the open division, you're gonna see critiques, and topicality and critiques are kind of hand in hand. So when we go into topicality, here's kind of like how we structure it. So topicality is created because we have like the framework of policy debate, right? We have a certain set of rules that we agree upon before we enter the space. We agree that we're gonna be debating the topic, which is like what we, like the overall topic, which is water resources. And we agree that we are going to be talking about a policy action that the United States federal government should be doing something, right? Those are the predetermined rules that we agree upon before we even step foot into a debate round. And we're saying that those rules are in place because it makes debate fair. And it makes debate fair. And the reason why we need debate to be fair is because it's an educational activity and we want to learn, right? So that is the whole scope of topicality, is that within policy debate, we have a predetermined set of rules before we step into the round. And we need to maintain those rules for the sake of fairness and education. That is the whole scope of topicality and like framework and things like that. However, the reason why we bring up topicality is if the affirmative brings in a plan or policy action that doesn't abide by those rules, we as a neg can say that they are not, that they're breaking those rules. And like the policy action that they're bringing in isn't topical, which means it doesn't relate to the topic. And that is bad because one, it makes the round no longer fair. So it's hard for the negative to argue against the app. And two, it's hard for us to have an educational debate because if we don't know what we're debating about, then we can't debate properly and it hurts our like learning experience within the round. So to boil this down, it's saying that the negative would bring in a topicality argument if the policy action that the AF is bringing isn't within the scope of the topic. And they're saying that you should not vote for that topic because one, it's bad for debate. And two, it's bad for fairness in education. Does that make sense? Okay, cool. So this one is kind of like, it's kind of weird because it steps out of like the realms of the debate round. So it's basically like saying, hey, time out. What are we doing here? Like before we can debate this policy action, we need to talk about the rules of engagement within debate. And if you aren't abiding by those rules, then we can no longer participate in this debate. So you're taking a step back and you're addressing the judge and being like, they're not playing fair. They're not arguing what we agreed upon before we entered this round. So we can no longer debate in this round because, you know, one, we weren't prepared to discuss this because it's not the topic. Two, it's not fair, like we weren't prepared. And then we can't have a good educational debate because we can't talk about it. So it has nothing to do per se with whether or not the plan is a good idea or a bad idea. It's just saying that the plan isn't within the realm of the debate that we were prepared to talk about today. Cool. And this can like look, and what I was talking about, like the rules and stuff, that's mostly like framework of debate, but specifically topicality gets into like the super, super like nitty-gritty parts of the plan text. So it's saying like if they use a word that doesn't really like fit the definition of like water resources, you can then take that one word that they said and be like, no, you're not bringing that word in here, it's not topical. So that goes into interpretation. So you can define a word from the resolution that excludes the app. So if you like, I'm trying to think of the resolution word for word. I don't have that on top of my head. But the resolution is talking about like, so say the resolution is saying that the United States federal government should protect ocean rights or whatever. I don't know if it says, but imagine that's a resolution, right? The resolution is about the ocean. And then the affirmative that we are debating has to do with rivers, you can then take the definition of the word river and then talk about how it has nothing to do with the ocean. And so therefore it's not topical and we cannot debate this, you know? So like interpret, or they say like a body of water and they don't specifically mention ocean, then you can say that's not topical because the topic is about the ocean, and the body of water can be like rivers, it can be like dams, it could be like literally anything. So, or it could be like the water on Mars, like, you know, it can literally be anything else. So you can interpret the word that's in the affirmative and then shows how it's not topical to the resolution. Does that make sense? Cool. And then
perfect sense.
Okay, cool. I'm just trying to make sure, like, all this theory debate like kind of can get a little confusing even for me, like trying to like verbally express it. So I'm just making sure. Perfect. So then that's the interpretation. So you take the word that what's in it and you show how it, the interpretation of the word does not fit the resolution. Violation, and you show how like the interpretation of it violates it. So again, how we said like, we define what body of water was, and you can say that violates what we're talking about because it doesn't specifically mean ocean. And then the standards again are like the, so violation, why does it matter? So you interpret it, violation, how does this exclude it? Standards are then what I was talking about earlier, how I said we need to maintain like this debate space because of fairness and education. So those are the standards, right? Education and fairness, those are the standards that we try to abide by within debate rounds. So you're saying by not mentioning the ocean in your plan text, and instead of going by bodies of water, we are no longer having a fair debate, nor are we having an educational one because we were not ready to debate all bodies of water. And it's not fair because we didn't have enough time to prepare to debate about all bodies of water. So this debate space is no longer going to be as educational as it could have been, because, you know, if we're prepared to debate, then we're going to have like clash, we're going to have an in-depth discussion, we're going to have like, you know, all those really good things to debate. But because we have like the word bodies of water and not ocean, we can't have that. We lose all that. So that is the standard. And then voters are reasons why the judge should care. So like, you're like, hey judge, bodies of waters isn't oceans. Like they should lose for that, right? The judge is like, why? Like, why should they lose? Like, why should I care that they said bodies of water and not the word oceans? So this is when you really lay out to the judge that the reason why they should vote for you is because of like the education and fairness argument. So like the standards are like what is in the round, and then voters are you explaining why education and fairness matter. So like interpretation, so just going back up and down, it's kind of like layers, like you're adding on layers to this. So the first one is you pick the word that excludes it and you define it. So you're saying bodies of waters is not oceans. Violation, you're saying since we define bodies of waters as anything and not ocean, it is a violation of the topic. Standards, you're like, since it's a violation, it goes against the standards of fairness and predictability. And that is why, judge, you should vote for us, because with fairness and education and predictability, we're having good debate, but we're having accessible debate that anybody can participate in. Does that make sense for topicality? Okay, any questions?
No, not so far.
Okay, cool. Topicality. Very wordy, it can get a little messy. So that's why voters are really important, because you can have a bunch of really, really great arguments as to why it's not topical, but unless you explain to the judge why that matters and why the judge should vote for you, the judge isn't gonna do it. Like they're like, okay, like bodies of waters isn't oceans, but why does that matter? And that's when you bring in those like fairness and education arguments. And of course, as you go into further into debate, you'll hit critiques. We'll go into critiques later, but like critiques are just like completely strap the plan action, the government's not doing anything, like something sometimes like that. That's when you get into framework, and framework and topicality are kind of like extensions of each other. So topicality is when you get like a kind of a policy action, but something's off within it. That's when you use topicality. But then you would bring in framework, which is basically this, but it's called different. Framework is when they don't even use a policy action. And you're like, hey, whoa, like this is totally different. We didn't expect this in debate. Like, I'm going off, but just look at it. The topicality is if there's a policy action, something's not like quite right with it. There's a word that you don't agree with or a word that doesn't quite fit the resolution. And that's when you run topicality and be like, this plan has no place in the round. It's not fair, blah, blah, blah. Any last questions about topicality before we move on? Case. So case is the single most important part of the negative side. If you don't argue anything else on the neg, so if you don't bring in disadvantages, if you don't bring in topicality, you can at least bring in case. And case is essentially arguing against their policy action, right? So if you don't argue against their plan, then what are you doing? You know, like you basically concede that their plan's a good idea and that the judge should vote for them because you haven't said otherwise. So remember how last at the workshop we went over inherency, advantages, and solvency, like the parts that make up the affirmative. So the case basically addresses each form of that and goes against it. So if the affirmative is saying that everybody should go vegan because it protects animals, it like lowers CO2 emissions and it's better for the environment, you have to hit those points. You have to say, one, going vegan doesn't protect animals because they use them to plant more crops. I don't know if it does. I'm making this up, right? And then you can say, two, they said that going vegan would actually increase CO2 emissions because now people are driving back and forth to get those vegetables out more. And three, it's actually worse for the environment because now you have all this soil that the crops are taking the nutrients out of it. And since they're not properly farming, it can lead to like soil degradation, which can then lead to like destruction of ecosystems and stuff like that. So it's basically just like tearing down all of the good points that they made and addressing it. So you address their solvency. You'd be like, there's no way that they can even implement this plan properly, or there's no way that going vegan would even protect the animals or like the planet. So case is basically just addressing their like home argument and making sure that you're just going against it. Any questions? All right. Okay, so now it's time to apply what we learned using the evidence packet. So we looked a little bit at the evidence packet over the weekend. Now it's time to look at the negative side. So this is a group activity, but since it's just me and you, we're in a group. So let me pull up the evidence packet. Give me 1 second, I'm gonna pull it up. All right, are you back? Oh, perfect. So, second half of debate practice, let's go. Negative evidence. So now we're just gonna like kind of look through the evidence. We can kind of do what we did. So there's a few ways we can go about this. We can either like read through the cards, we can talk about it, like summarize it, make sure you understand it. We can read through the cards and then highlight the most important. Oh my God, I was not getting that sentence out. We can highlight the cards and highlight the most important sentence like we did like at camp. How like we just read the paragraph and then we highlight the most important sentence. Yeah, so it's really up to you. Which one do you think you would want to do?
Might be helpful if I turn on my mic. Okay. I think we could just read through every card and talk about it.
Okay, perfect. So let's go through the advantages. So I should also just go over the structure. So if you can on Google Docs have like this table of contents show up in like the top left. And I find that that's the easiest when operating like online packets because you can kind of see like everything instead of having to scroll through it to find the answers. You can just look here. So you'll find disadvantages, economy disadvantages, you'll find answers. So whenever you see answers, those are just responses to what the affirmative have brought up. So if you're like, what is an advantage answer? It's just like answering the problem that, well, not answering the problem. It's a response to the advantages that are brought up in the affirmative. So that's when you see answers. And then you have solvency answers. So it's a response to like the solvency cards that are brought up. And then when you see extensions, in the 2NC, so like, you know, in the second constructive speech, how you're like extending what they said in the first speech. Whenever you see extensions, those are just like cards that elaborate further on the original point that was brought up. So if you can see economy extensions, those are just like cards that elaborate more on the economy cards that are brung up in the 1NC. So it's just like, it's just further explaining some of the cards that are brung up before. Okay, then we see more answers and more extensions. Okay, cool, yeah, cool. Let's start with the disadvantages, since those are first. So the first is econ disadvantage. Do you want to like alternate read? Like I read a card, you read a card? Or do you want to read it on your own and then we can discuss it?
We can do you read a card, I read a card.
Okay, perfect. Just dropped my notebook. Okay, sounds good. So I'll start with this card and then we'll like alternate. So current environmental rules protect rivers while supporting economic growth. Wheeler 20. Thanks to our new rule, I need to like increase the font because I cannot see it. I don't need glasses, I swear. Okay, thanks to our new rule, farmers, developers, manufacturers, and other landowners can finally refocus on providing the food, shelter, and other commodities that Americans rely on every day instead of spending tens of thousands of dollars on attorneys and consultants to determine whether waters on their own land fall under the control of the federal government. Our new rule protects our nation's water resources. It provides certainty and predictability that will save Americans time and money while accelerating infrastructure projects and economic development. Other federal programs, such as the Great Lakes Program, will continue to ensure that America's water protections remain strong while giving states and tribes the flexibility and certainty to manage their waters in ways that best protect their natural resources and local economies. Cool, cool, cool. Do you have any questions on this one?
I'm just reading.
Oh no, you're totally fine. Yeah, I forgot to go over it. Yeah, let's talk about this card a little bit. So the reason why it's a disadvantage, like it sounds like it's kind of like supporting like the plan a little bit, right? Like it's kind of really worded because it says current environmental rules protect rivers while supporting economic growth. So it's kind of, okay. So the plan text is saying that we should grant legal protections to rivers. That is what the AF is saying. But this disadvantage is saying that current environmental rules protect rivers while supporting economic growth. So remember I told you the neg is in support of the status quo or in support of what's currently going on. This is why this is a disadvantage, because it's saying currently in the status quo, we have rules that protect rivers and it also helps grow our economy. So we're saying currently we're doing fine right now. Yeah, like in the status quo, we're doing good, right? We have rules that protect our environment and that are helping our economy grow. So there's no need for the AF plan because we already have this covered. That's why this is a disadvantage, because it's saying that if we pass the plan, it'll then kind of like push what we currently have going on to the side, and that's bad because of XYZ. All right, perfect, perfect, perfect. All right, next card. Oh wow, you got an easy one.
Okay. Do you want me to read all of the card or just the underlined or just, underlined?
Yeah, tagline and underlined.
Cool. Granting rights to rivers will collapse the economy. Many businesses will be unable to operate. Smith 18. Granting rights to nature would bring economic growth to a screeching halt by empowering radical environmentalists, granted legal standing to act on nature's behalf to impose their extreme views through the buzzsaw of unending litigation. Backed by well-funded environmentalist organizations and their lawyers, any and all large-scale economic or development projects, from oil drilling to house developments to renewable energy projects, could face years of harassing lawsuits.
Perfect, great. So this card, so you see how in the first card, they're saying that like what we currently have going on is really great. We can protect rivers, it's growing the economy. This card is saying that the reason why we shouldn't pass the AV is because we're doing so great now that if we were to pass the AV plan and grant legal protection over these rivers, then all of these businesses that are currently operating through the use of these rivers will no longer be able to have the same access that they had to it before, which would then hurt the economy because all of their businesses, all of the projects that they had going on that contribute to the economy will no longer be able to operate in the same capacity. Now, is this necessarily a strong card? That's up for debate. I feel like if you were the F, you could argue that this card is the reason why we need the plan. It's because people are using the, like, using rivers for, like, their own personal gain. And this kind of, like, highlights it a bit. But then you also get into the debate on whether or not we should prioritize, like, our environment or our economy, you know? So that's kind of, like, the debate. Like, there's a lot of different factors that go into this. But this is just one stance that the negative could take. Cool. Any questions before we move on? Perfect. So economic decline causes world war, you know, in debate. We're always somehow ending up at either nuclear war or just regular war. Somehow in policy, you're always going to have a war. But this is Sundaram 19. We will look up the authors how to pronounce him. As fears arise of financial crisis, there are growing concerns about the increased possibility of large-scale military conflict. Prolonged economic crisis could easily spin out of control and morph into a military conflict in world war. Another round of economic stress is deemed likely to foment unrest, conflict, even war, as it is blamed on the foreign. Rising economic insecurity strengthen nationalist sentiments, exasperate tensions, leading to conflicts and tensions among countries. So the classic economic decline causes war is that whenever there's economic instability within a country, to make up for it, they'll participate in war because, you know, it creates jobs, because people have to make weapons, they have to, like, you know, get fuel, all of that good stuff. They have to strengthen, like, you know, camaraderie among countries. So yeah, the classic, like, anytime the economy needs to, like, increase, they'll cause war to increase the economy. So we're saying we should not pass the plan, because if we pass the plan, it's going to decrease our economy. And when we decrease our economy, we get into wars. So that's kind of, like, the steps. All right, next one.
Read the underlined or highlighted.
Ooh, good question. Let's just do underlined. Cool.
Biodiversity loss won't cause extinction. Carvia 18. One boundary often mentioned as a concern for the fate of global civilization is biodiversity. There's little evidence that this particular 0.001% initial loss is a threshold, and it is hard to imagine any data that would allow one to identify where the threshold was. While there are data that relate local reductions in species richness to altered ecosystem function, these results do not point to substantial existential risks. Data are small-scale experiments in which plant productivity or nutrient retention is reduced as species numbers decline locally. Those are not existential risks. To make the link even more tenuous, there is little evidence that BioD is even declining at local scales. Total planetary BioD may be in decline, but local and regional BioD is often staying the same because species from elsewhere replace local losses. There is growing skepticism regarding the strength of evidence linking trends in biodiversity loss to an existential risk for humans. Obviously, if all biodiversity disappeared, civilization would end, but no one is forecasting the loss of all species. If global biodiversity were halved, but at the same time, locally, the number of species stayed in relatively stable, what would be the mechanism for an end of civilization or even end of human prosperity scenario? Extinctions and biodiversity loss are ethical and spiritual losses, but perhaps not an existential risk.
Perfect. All right. So again, this is an answer to a previous card. As you can see, like how it says biodiversity loss won't cause extinction. We're like, where did that come from? Like it's just randomly in there. Well, on the 1AC, there is a biodiversity advantage. Let me see. I don't see exactly biodiversity, but it talks about like ecosystems.
I think it was the one that starts with maintaining the health of the U.S. is the one because it's talking about biodiversity loss.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, because it talks about like how rivers like maintain our ecosystems, and that's important because, like, you know, it's how we get our food, energy, blah, 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 right? So the NEG comes in with an advantage answer, which was what we just previously read, which is saying that the decline is not going to cause extinction. Like, it's going to be super, super minimal. And even if it is, like, impactful, it won't cause human extinction. Like, it won't have that big of an impact because we still have other mechanisms in place to protect us against extinction. So they're just saying that extinction is super, super unlikely. And when we get into rebuttals, which is when we talk about like impact calculation, I know we did some impact calc. Did we do impact calc on camp? I can't remember.
I'm not sure. Impact calc seems more like a policy thing.
Probably. Okay. I'm confusing it with like other years, but the more we talk about like policy debate, because this is like only your second practice in policy, we'll go over something called impact calculation, which is kind of like weighing which things we should evaluate more. And one of those like weighing things is like likeliness of something to happen, right? So this one basically talks about like how likely is it that those loss of rivers is going to have such an impact on biodiversity that we become extinct, right? Like how likely is that to possible? So the app is saying it's super, super likely, right? But this card is now diminishing, like lowering the chances of extinction happening and be like, it's not as likely as we think it's going to be. So therefore the judge shouldn't vote on it because it's not going to happen, right? So it's kind of going on to like, why should the judge vote for each side? And you're saying like the judge shouldn't vote for this because it's super, super unlikely that it's going to cause extinction. So by the affirmative saying that, you're like, they're exaggerating. Like, it's not that deep. Like, it's not going to happen. So that is just something to look out for. Next card. Okay. Water is sustainable. It cycles. Stress is different than scarcity. Broman 16. Again, we will look up the proper pronunciation of these authors before the tournament. So water crises seem to be everywhere. For all the hoopla, even California has a run out of water. There are a lot of water on the planet. Earth's total renewable fresh water adds up to about 10 million cubic kilometers. And it's also large, something for like 4 trillion Olympic-sized swimming pools. Water crisis isn't just about how much water there is. A water shortage happens when we want more water than we have in a specific place at a specific time. You're probably in trouble if you're using up to 100% of your water or even 75%, but only local context can illuminate that. Globally, just 2% of watersheds use more than 75% of their total renewable water. So this is an interesting card. Because it doesn't really specifically talk about like fresh water, because that's really what we're debating about is like the fresh water like availability, which is like rivers, streams, things like that. But it's a card nonetheless, so we're going to talk about it. I'm going to take a note of this card also. Got to pick up my notebook that I dropped. Because we're also like working on the packet as we go. So this is number 49. The saying is that they're like, don't worry about the rivers. They're like, there's plenty of water everywhere. Like, as long as we're not 100% using all of the water in a river, then we'll be fine. Like, it cycles, it rains, we get more. Like, don't worry about it. So that's basically what this card is talking about. So because it's like, California's in a drought, we haven't run out of water. So why should we stress about running out of water? It's an interesting card. It's an argument nonetheless, and it's in your pocket if you ever need it. So if they're like, we should care about rivers because we're gonna run out of water, we're in a drought, you're like, don't worry about it. California's been in a drought for so long and we still have water. So let's calm down. Yeah. That's this card. The water's everywhere. It cycles through. You don't like, just because we are like diminishing our numbers doesn't mean we're going to run out. Like, yeah. Interesting card. You don't have to use it, but it's there if you need it.
That was the one.
Did you say something before?
No, I was just about to read the water sustainable card.
Oh, did I skip?
No, that was the one.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Advances in technology will prevent the worst consequences of environmental destruction. 19. I don't know how to say the name.
Yeah, we'll look it up.
Innovative new technologies turned out to be cheaper, more efficient, and more productive. Exponential growth is not only possible, it is exactly what you'd expect in a world where you do not increase your resource or greenhouse gas footprint. The primary route to dematerialization is through innovation. There is no reason why the future cannot be clearer, quieter, and more secure, as well as more efficient, productive, and innovative. Our species developed effective vaccines for COVID-19 in record time. For all of our failings as stewards of the planet, innovation is one thing humans excel at.
Perfect. So, yeah, they're saying we'll be fine, right? Like, we have, technology is increasing so much that we'll be able to solve all of the world's problems. Like, don't worry about environmental destruction. Like, we got COVID vaccines in a year. We can fix the environment in like 3. So yeah, it's just saying that, like, with the rapid improvement of technologies, we'll be able to either dispel or like outweigh any consequences that not protecting rivers will cause. Solvency answers. I don't want to get too, this is a lot for one day. So let's cut it off after, like, let's just go through the answers and then we can debrief, because I also don't want you to get like too far ahead from like other students, because I know you're like, you hit the workshop and now you're already on next. So I just don't like, you know, get the pace kind of like similar. So we'll go through the solvency answers. We'll debrief for today and yeah, we'll regroup. All right. So river rights won't do anything. They will have all the same problems as existing environmental law. DARPO 21. I do not share the view that RON entails a shift of paradigm in law that has capacity to save the environment. The environment problems, which will be remedied by introducing new labels in a system still handled by humans. The history of RON, or R-O-N, shows any alternative faces the same challenges. Most importantly, lofty legislation not adapting to the nature of the environment, deferral to economic growth, weak enforcement, and lack of funding for environmental interests. The limiting factor is not that nature does not have rights, but lack of public support for radical change. The fundamental direction society will not change. So this one is saying that this is low-key a root cause argument. Like, have you heard of a root cause argument before?
No.
Okay. So a root cause is when you're not getting to the underlying problem, like the underlying issue of a problem. So it's kind of like if you look at a tree, like if you cut off a branch, the tree is still going to continue to grow because the roots are still there. So in order to like get rid of the tree completely, you have to dig it up from the roots. So this is basically kind of like a root cause. Like, I feel like it's teetering on a root cause argument. So they're saying like the problem isn't that no one's protecting the rivers, it's that no one cares about the rivers, right? So we're saying that even if we do have these policy actions protecting them, that mindset that people have that rivers are not important, that they're a commodity, is still going to be there. So they're still going to mistreat the environment. So it's like people are still like going to litter because they don't care about the environment, but you protected rivers, right? So it's like the root cause is that we need to like shift our mindset into like the environment's important. It needs to be protected. It needs to be, it's like a sacred space. Once we then shift that mindset, then we can then protect it, because the laws won't mean anything if nobody enforces it, if nobody listens to it, if nobody like actually pays attention to it. So this is what it's saying, that like we need to address the roots, which is like the lack of care for like the environment. And once we solve like for that mindset, then we can protect the environment. But if we just ignore that and cut off the branch and like slap on this legal protection over rivers, it's not really going to change much. So that's what this one is saying. Any questions?
How do you say that country's name?
Oh, Ecuador.
Ecuador. Okay.
Yeah.
Ecuador and Bolivia prove that rights for smoothie right now. Okay. Sorry. prove that rights for nature fails. O'Donnell 18. Legal rights are only worth having if they can be enforced. To enforce legal rights for a river, several practical factors must be accounted for. An individual or organization must act on a river's behalf. Capacity in the forms of time, money, and expertise may need to be available so that rights of rivers can be upheld in court. River representatives and funding sources are likely to need independence from state and national governments, as well as sufficient real-world power to take action, particularly if such action is politically controversial. Historically, these factors have been absent where legal rights have been granted to nature. As a result, legal rights for nature have been difficult to enforce. Ecuador and Bolivia, few cases have been successfully upheld, and local actors responsible for enforcement lacked capacity to translate the legal decision into outcomes.
Perfect. Thank you. So this kind of goes hand in hand with the previous card. It's just talking about, like, just because we slap on legal protections doesn't mean that it's safe, because at the end of the day, it relies on the enforcement of these protections and on the people's mindset. So if people aren't enforcing these legal protections, then people are going to continue to, like, abuse rivers and just do whatever they want with it and not really, like, appreciate it and just waste its resources. So we're saying that since people aren't enforcing these legal protections, the only way to save it, going back to this card, is if we change the mindset, right? Because we can't rely on people to enforce it, because we have the example of Ecuador and Bolivia not enforcing these legal actions. So that's kind of why this card, I feel like, is kind of important, because it's saying, because we know that no one's going to, like, enforce these legal protections, the only way to really save it is if we change our mindsets, and, like, people decide for themselves that they're going to protect rivers. Card, last card, we're pumping through these, okay? This is not easy. I feel like the hardest part is actually physically, like, reading and understanding the evidence packet. But once you do that, you're dangerous. Like, you'll conquer it, because a lot of people just don't read the pack. So, like, they'll be debating and, like, low-key not understanding what they're saying. But if you read the pack, you'll go so far in novice. Like, that's my one piece of advice. Like, if you do nothing else, read the pack. Because that's what you'll get most, like, all your questions are will be answered. But continuing, so human guardianship for nature doesn't work. We'll figure this out. 19. One should be more cautious before speaking about the legal revolution when discussing Ron Ron and Dana Shelton held. Environmentalists may be concerned that inevitably the legal personhood of nature will have to be defended by humans. Appointed by the government, environmental concerns may not always be paramount. Any guardians will have responsibility for developing and management plans and deciding on what particular activities should be permitted. In theory, environmental agencies already undertake these responsibilities in respect to public land and protected areas. Substantive norms put forward by RON, Ron, and we'll figure that out, do not differ substantially from the protection schemes set out by modern environmental law. So what is this card saying? I think it's basically saying, let's read this one more time. It's saying that smaller environmental agencies should be the one to enforce this. So yeah, I think it's saying that, like, I guess it's changing the actor of the plan. So the actor originally within the app is the federal government, but this card is saying that we should then, instead of having the federal government grant legal protections over this, we should then have, and, like, enforce it, we should have local environmental agencies be the ones to protect our rivers, because they're already doing most of the groundwork already. Perfect, perfect, perfect. So we will stop there. So we stopped at solvency answers, and so we did half of the neg, and we will get, ooh, there's a lot. We'll get to the other half next week. I just don't want you to get too far ahead of, like, everybody else. I kind of want everybody to be on the same, hopefully the same level. So when people join us next week, we can get them further, like, into the evidence cards. But of course, if you want to read ahead at home, totally, totally feel free to do so, because you already got it.